church. Is everyone all hopped up on sugar from last night?
Yes.
I know my kids are. All right, we're going to start our service this morning with some songs praising our Savior and singing about our relationship with God and others. If you want to stand up and join us, we're going to start off with This Is Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
We're going to continue to sing of our great God with Great I Am.
Oh, But so if you have a young child or something that just needs a break, feel more than welcome to bring them back there. And then next week, we're going to get started our young kids ministry. We're kind of going slow because we want to meet all the regulations and stuff. And then also, it's just short on staff because attendance has been, you know, it's all over the place. And so Linda has graciously offered to help me run that young kids ministry. And if anybody's interested or anyone has any extra time that they'd be willing to, you know, dedicate maybe 1 week a month or something like that, that would be greatly appreciated. It'd be a great ministry to the kids too and to the parents. And so just please be considering that, because it'd be nice to kind of get that up and running again so we can give the kids of our church a little bit more intentional discipleship. We also have a few different things starting up. There's going to be a Bible study on Thanksgiving starting tomorrow at 7 p.m. And Rob's leading that. Do you have anything you wanted to add about that or any details or anything?
It'll be a Zoom, so we'll be sending out the Zoom link to the church. If you're not on the email list, make sure you let me know so that you can get that link.
Okay. Yeah, so if you are interested in that and you don't have Rob's email or anything, please let him know and he can set you up with the link for the Zoom meeting. Then we also have student Bible study, and that's me at the Crotts. And do you guys have anything to say about that?
Everybody's welcome. We live on campus at Crown College, and so we put out a time for dinner, so people want to eat with us. That'll be part of what we do. And it's going to be every other week at our place, not every week, but every other week.
Okay. So every other week, and meal is included, which is awesome. And then we also have the Book of Common Prayer group that's starting up on Tuesday. Sam's already said that he's interested in that. And then I just wanted to kind of give you a brief explanation of some of the Book of Common Prayer stuff. So who's heard of the Book of Common Prayer? Awesome. Basically, the structure of the Book of Common Prayers is just a way to kind of guide and direct our spiritual disciplines towards God. And so it starts with the confession of sins. There's several prayers and creeds that are said. And then one of the great things, and then there's reading from Psalms, the Old Testament, and the New Testament. And so it's very scripture-focused with ancient prayers. And one of the nice things about it is it kind of orients your year based on the Christian calendar and not necessarily on the other things that might be going on, like the election coming up or our plans for that weekend or different things like that. So does anybody know what today is in the Christian calendar? All Saints Day. So just to give you kind of a taste of what the Book of Common Prayer sounds like, this is one of the prayers that they have specifically for this day. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtues and godly living, that we may come to those infallible joys that you prepare for those who truly love you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God in glory everlasting. Amen. And so there's quite a bit of different sections of prayer like that, so if you're interested in that, please let me know, and I can get you the information. And then with that, let's just pray for Rob to come up and share his message with us. Dear God, thank you for giving us this opportunity to come together and worship you and to look into your word. I ask that you would fill Rob with your Holy Spirit as he comes up and gives the message that he's prepared. Thank you for working in him throughout the week so that he would you have plan and prepare for this message, but we ask that he would submit all that over to you, that you would be speaking through him, and that as a result of our time together this morning, each one of us would have a deeper relationship with you and deeper relationship with one another. We ask that in all things you may be glorified and your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to the river. How's everybody doing? Yes. Hey, Josh. Can you look at the board over there? And number 19 or 20 on the soundboard, maybe turn that down just a little bit. I think I'm maybe a little hot. Yeah? I'm a little hot. That was kind of a little loud. Josh is like, what? Is that good?
Turn it down.
Is that better? Okay, good. Thanks. So first of all, I want to mention that song, Jake, The Great I Am, that fits really well with the sermon for today, so I thought that was really cool. So you'll see that later on. Also, I do want to say a big thank you to those who came out to our community garden cleanup with Envision. Yesterday, we had about 13 of us there, and that was a great time we were cleaning up a community garden that was used by, specifically meant for Bhutanese refugees, and so that was really cool to be able to do that, to get that done. And my hope is that we can continue to develop a partnership with Envision and do more with them on a regular basis. So be watching for more information about that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this time together. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity to gather on Sunday mornings to seek you together. We pray that you would bless this sermon time. We pray that you would help us to be attentive to what you want to say. And I pray specifically for me that you would help me to be open to you, just hearing your Holy Spirit and knowing the direction you want me to take as I speak. And that you receive all the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. So last night was Halloween I know that it's Halloween is a different topic that some people celebrate, some people don't celebrate, and all that kind of stuff. I'm not going to get into all that. But it's funny because I think it fits well with the sermon topic for today, and I wasn't even planning that. The sermon, I got all the way through preparing the sermon, and then I got to yesterday and was thinking of a sermon illustration to open with, and I was like, man, today's Halloween, or yesterday was Halloween. And there just seems some fitting stuff here. So my oldest daughter, Ansley, actually got dressed up for a party, and she went out dressed as a character from Among Us. How many of you know what Among Us is? For those of you who don't know, it is a fun little game that you can play on your phone or tablet that is really popular amongst the younger generation right now. And amongst me, I actually enjoy playing it. Although that probably lowers its cool quotient a little bit. So, anyway.
That's okay.
Yeah. Thanks. She was dressed up as I won't go into the detail, but while that was a fun character for her to dress up as, a lot of the most popular costumes that people wear at Halloween are things like witches and ghosts and angels and devils and horror movie villains and vampires and zombies and fairies and skeletons and scary clowns and the Grim Reaper and all of those kind of things. And I think it's because our culture is very interested in the supernatural and in the spiritual realm. We see it in Halloween costumes, but also in popular movies, books, TV shows, even songs. There's a draw to all of that, that people are preoccupied with spiritual things. But the spiritual realm is not fictional, right? Now, there are fictional ways it is depicted. There are, like in the books and in the movies and some of these things, the spiritual realm is not necessarily depicted in the reality of what it is, but the spiritual realm itself is not fictional. It is real. And in the midst of that realm, there's a battle waging that we often don't pay attention to. But today, that's what we're going to talk about. So please turn up in your Bibles to the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. We're going to look at probably a relatively familiar passage. You've probably heard of this passage before. But let's start with a little background. What do you know about Ephesians?
Paul wrote it.
Good.
Church in Ephesus.
To the church in Ephesus. Good. Anyone else? By the way, I found out this morning that after I came here and was drinking my tea, I realized that one of the tea bags must have split open, and so I've got stuff in there. So if you ever see me throw a weird face after, I still need to take a drink every once in a while because it's for my throat, but yeah. So if you see me go, that's why. Anyway. Anyone else? Ephesians.
It's kind of like a mini Romans in the sense that it contains the whole gospel, but like more concisely than Romans
says. Yeah, much more concisely. Yeah, for sure. There's some correlation there between Ephesians and Romans. It's a very different book. Ephesians is somewhat difficult, even maybe not controversial, but some of the ways Paul expresses stuff is like different than the ways he expressed himself in other passages, which is interesting. So, yeah. Anyone else? So, letter written by Paul, church in Ephesus. Ephesus was a place that Paul probably spent 2 or 3 years establishing the church on his third missionary journey. He is writing this, though, from a prison, most likely in prison in Rome, probably near the end of his imprisonment, end of a long imprisonment. So this is about 7 years after he had actually been in Ephesus, most likely. Ephesus was one of the largest cities in the Roman Empire, the leading city in the Roman Empire in Asia. Today it would be located in modern-day Turkey. It was home of one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world. Does anybody know which one? The Temple to Artemis, or the Roman goddess Diana, as she's also known by. Actually, if anybody has the game 7 Wonders, one of my favorite games is that you actually have a board called Ephesus, which is kind of fun. In addition to that famous temple, they also had several temples. And these other temples were specifically for the imperial cult, so it was for the worship of the emperor. And it was considered a religious center. So not just did they have these different temples, but they had a fascination with the occult, with magic, with the supernatural overall. And the people were just focused on a lot of these different, like on the spiritual realm, which is very pertinent because that's one of his topics. One of the things that Paul digs into in this letter is this spiritual realm. And that's what we're gonna talk about today. So let's start with verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. What do you think Paul means when he says, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might? Yeah.
I think he means to not rely on our own capabilities, but to be pursuing our ability to endure through Christ.
Yes. Yeah, I agree. I think what he's saying here is specifically contrasting that with being strong in ourselves. So he's saying, be strong, but don't just be strong in yourself. Be strong in the Lord. Rely upon his strength, the strength of his might, rather than upon your own strength. Right? Good. Have you ever felt overwhelmed in your walk with the Lord or just in daily life? You ever felt overwhelmed? Yeah, I have, right?
I was just going to say, like, maybe it's kind of like a stress relief, kind of a cast all your cares on him.
Wow, Towner quoting scripture. That was nice. Yes, very much so. Cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Very good. Yeah. So Paul is focusing on recognizing the fact that we don't have the strength that we need. That the strength that we need for walking this life comes from him. And so we need to be strong in the Lord rather than strong in ourselves. And I actually think that's one of the main points of this entire passage, is reminding us of that, of reminding us of his strength rather than our own strength. So keep that in mind as we go throughout this passage. Notice Paul follows it up with the instruction to put on the full armor of God that we can stand against the devil's schemes. So we're going to get to the armor in a minute, but first let's focus on the other part. What does he mean by the devil's schemes? Okay, don't be tempted by the devil and what he does. Good. Anyone else? Man, that one had a lot of grounds.
Maybe it's that he's alluding to the fact that there actually is an organized plan that the devil has.
Yes. So like, so it's not just random things, but that he actually has a plan, like a plan of attack against us. Good. Not good, but good answer. Right? Yeah. Good. So recognizing that our ability, that because the devil has these schemes, the ability to stand against them comes from God. Good. Anyone else? Oh, good.
Because it's the word scheme.
Deception.
It can be easily deceived. And so needing God's wisdom and discernment to identify them and then be able to stand.
That's good. So realizing that the devil is tricky and that he actually, so he uses this deception, and so his schemes may not necessarily be obvious.
Exactly.
Good. Good. You know, elsewhere scripture speaks of the devil as a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. But that's his goal. The devouring can look a lot of different ways, though. There's a lot of different schemes he uses, depending upon the person, depending upon the time. He tires us out, he discourages us, he speaks lies to us. Tries to get us confused or chasing after the wrong things. He tempts us and tricks us and lays traps for us and tries to get us to question God and his will for our lives and on and on and on. He has all kinds of different schemes. He has a plan of attack that is very thorough. It's like he knows our weak points and wants to go there. These are schemes of the devil to try to draw us away from God and to cause us to become ineffective in our faith. And Paul says in verse 12 that our battle really isn't against flesh and blood. He's saying that there's this spiritual battle waging that we don't fully understand or see. What do you think about that? What do you think about this spiritual battle? Yeah. So it's like it's almost like we misunderstand who our enemy really is, and our enemy becomes the physical world rather than what's behind that, the spiritual stuff. So our energies get focused on our neighbor Bob or on the politics or on COVID or so on and so forth, whatever it might be, rather than on the true enemy. Anyone else? Your thoughts on that? This is a more general question, so it's pretty open to your thoughts on that. Spiritual battle as a whole. Yeah.
I think it puts us in an interesting place, like trying to find a balance between taking this as the reality that it clearly is because it's described in the Bible, but also not like creating two separate entities between like physical
yes.
and spiritual as like completely separate, because I think the idea here mm-hmm. is that
tied together. Yeah. Yeah, like they're so not becoming so like it's a spiritual battle here and a physical battle here, but that they're tied, that there's a relational aspect to this. Good. I like that. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah.
My wife brought up the the analogy of like the Hunger Games. You read the Hunger Games.
Yes.
How the children who are in this arena battling, the real enemy is it's President Snow and the government, and they're just focused on winning the games instead of defeating the worker.
Yeah, yeah. Sometimes you almost feel in the midst of it like you have to, just to survive, you have to focus on the physical piece.
Yeah.
But your real enemy is not that. Yeah, the Hunger Games is a good, good picture of that. They should have been fighting the Capitol.
Yep.
Good. Anyone else? This is good insight.
I feel like a lot of this also has to do with like our position. So like in verse 10 to now, like, all of it kind of always runs into like we need to know our position to the Lord, that we are children of His, and like, and I think it all actually is like if our struggles against the rulers and authorities, our position is really important as well, because the more we struggle against authorities, you know, we're not meant to be a subordinate group, you know, plotting, but our true kingship is in heaven.
Yeah.
And that also, I mean, that affects, that theme affects the whole viewing of it, because then also being strong in the Lord is remembering that our position is with Him.
Yep.
And, like, I think that that
I totally agree, Elliot. And actually, I think you'll see that as we go throughout this passage. I think really the key when it comes to the armor is recognizing our position. And I think when we come, when it comes to, that was just a cough. that it's seriously like the we can get caught up fighting a battle rather than recognizing our position. And I think that that's important, that there's an important distinction there that I think we want to be careful of, because we can, we end up not being able to discern how we're supposed to fight. We end up fighting in ways that we're not supposed to fight rather than simply realizing who we are and being able to stand firm. Good.
And
the
Ephesians starts with our relationship with Christ. So it really is a coming full circle at the end here. So if you read the whole book,
yep.
You recognize that's how we started the book. So I think that's a really good point.
Yeah. Yeah, this passage is about the spiritual battle, but one of the main themes of Ephesians is salvation and the exaltation of Christ, right? Understanding that whole idea and who we are in that because of that is really important. Good. Anyone else? Yes.
It's kind of a short blurb, but like we used to have a neighbor named Donna. And she was really cool. She was born again believer since she was 45. And she was really, it's like, it seems like we see like polar opposites in like the awareness of this. Like there's some people that are like, I just don't even know what this is, because I'm football.
Yep.
And then there's people that like really embrace it and kind of go over the top.
Yeah.
And it was really interesting talking to Don. She has a really long history with the occult, and she came out of that. And seeing her like, having conversations with her, like, this is really relevant, because it's not like it's one or the other. It's kind of like our actions do have consequences, like in the physical and in the spiritual realm.
Yeah.
And like, it was interesting having, because I used to have a long conversation with Don about this.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting that that across the church as a whole, you have some people who are like either ignorant of the idea of a spiritual battle or just don't want to think about it at all. Like it's not even on the radar. No, everything is just physical, and they try to explain everything based upon just what we can see and kind of ignore the spiritual battle altogether. Then there are some people who are on the opposite side who like see a demon under every rock kind of thing. They're so in tune and everything is explained that way. And then there's people, yeah, I mean, that's like kind of the spectrum, you know, but there's people all across that. And there are some people too, I think, this doesn't fit with the whole spectrum idea, maybe it's like a third piece, but there are some people who believe that there is the spiritual realm, but just deny it. Like they just, like, let's just not, like, I don't want to think about that piece. Notice in verse 12, Paul speaks of us wrestling not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, authorities, cosmic powers, all that. That suggests that we are active participants in this. right? Like we don't have a choice. That the wrestling that we are doing is against the spiritual realm, not just the physical. And so if that's true, then we need to not ignore the spiritual realm. We need to recognize that it does exist and that it matters. And we need to know our enemy. We need to understand his schemes and the plan that he has and how he's working against us. And I think the first step is recognizing the spiritual battle. And to some extent, I think part of why Paul is writing this is to help open our eyes to say, you know, there is this spiritual battle. Like don't just treat everything as if that doesn't exist. And then he goes on to talk about facing it. Let's take a look at verse 15. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. You know, it's no surprise that Paul uses this kind of an illustration here, this idea of armor, while he's sitting there in prison, chained to a guard. Right? I mean, the guard himself is, the guard is probably not, like, fully dressed in battle gear, ready to go out. But still, being chained every day to this guard, he probably, like, it would make sense for him to be thinking along the ways of how what we are faced with, there is a spiritual battle, and this idea of the armor that is needed. I think that it makes a lot of sense that he would use this illustration. So what is the purpose of this armor, according to verse 12? Or sorry, 13. What's the purpose of the armor? Yeah.
Spirit of the Lord.
Okay. But what is it? What is it to do?
Protects you.
Protects us. Yeah. Notice that, so it says, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Or to stand firm. To be able to handle the... So the purpose of the armor is to help us to be able to continue to stand in the face of the evil, the spiritual battle that is taking place, that is being waged against us. The purpose is to stand. Yeah?
It almost reminds me of finishing the race.
Good.
And, like, I don't know, thinking of in order to finish that race, like, you know.
Here's some resources.
You need the armor. You need this armor in order to, not to, like, you know, mix verses together and whatnot, but
yeah,
that's kind of what popped into my head.
Kind yeah. of piggybacking off that, the idea of like, Paul does kind of like the endurance needed to finish the race.
Yeah.
In a sense, we know what the end result is for this battle that we're in. We know that God is a victor and that we get that victory through him. But that doesn't mean that there's not a battle. We're told we're in that battle.
Yeah.
And so he's just saying, like, we know what the end result is, but this is how you're going to go about getting there.
Yeah, it is hard because we are thinking of the fact that Jesus already won this, but that does, I mean, it's very clear here where he's saying you are in a battle, that there is this battle being waged. Even if you already, you know, believe that God has won, there's still this battle. Good. Yeah?
I just have a question. So, since Paul is in the evil day, so is that talking about, like, every day is evil, or is it pointing towards times?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a combination. I think it's looking ahead to, so, and even the commentaries I read, they talk about it with the idea of the evil day. They're looking ahead to what will be gone through before Christ's return. But also just in the idea that the days themselves are evil, that there is, that the days we are living in, that we are faced with this regular onslaught and ongoing battle.
So it's like building up.
A building up, crescendo that is coming, yeah. Yep, yep. At least that's the way I would read it. So, yeah. So Paul then spent some time specifically going into the detail of the armor. Let's take a look at the beginning of verse 14. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So that's a pretty complete description, right? I mean, like, literally, you have belt, breastplate, shoes, shield, helmet, sword. And each one, Paul has a purpose for it. Now, we could spend a lot of time digging into each piece of the armor and the imagery of how that protects the different parts of our body and all that kind of stuff. But what I want to focus more on is the spiritual characteristics of each piece. So first, Paul mentions this belt of truth. And what he's actually saying is to gird up your loins. What does it mean to gird up your loins? Anyone?
It's a term. Before you prepare yourself for action.
Yes.
It's like all of your tunics and stuff so that you don't get caught up as you're fighting or wrestling or running or what have you.
Yeah. So basically, it's just simply the idea of preparedness. It's like being ready to face whatever it is that you have to face. And so when he speaks of the belt of truth here, that's what he's talking about is being ready, like the prepared for the battle. And so why truth? Why does he say prepared for the truth? Why truth?
I think maybe because the primary weapon that we're fighting against is it's not physical, but it's actually truth versus lies. So
yeah.
Satan's strongest weapon is the lie.
Yeah, I totally agree. Satan is known as the father of lies, right? I mean, that's one of his ways he's known by. We see way back even in the beginning with Adam and Eve and the serpent in the Garden of Eden, and how his whole goal, the serpent's whole goal, was to try and get them to be confused and to doubt God and to mistrust him and to not believe that God had their best interests in mind. The serpent said, "Did God really say that you can't eat of the trees in the garden?" And then he said, "You will not surely die if you eat the fruit from that tree." Satan twists things, and he speaks half-truths and lies and tries to get us to not be able to discern the truth anymore. Have you ever found yourself in that position? Have you ever found yourself confused, unsure of the truth? Not certain of how to proceed. And now I have. I think anxiety and depression and doubt and a lot of those things spring out of lies. And the best way for us to fight against lies is to know the truth. So how do we do that? How do we put on truth? Knowing scripture? Good. Immersing ourselves in it? Good. Anyone else?
Remind yourself of the truth on a regular basis.
So constantly being immersed in the truth? Good. So knowing the truth, I think, also specifically means knowing Christ. Like really knowing him and abiding in him and immersing ourselves in him and recognizing that he is the truth. So we need to spend that time with him. You know, Jesus also said, if we continue in his word, then we will be his disciples and we will know the truth, and the truth will do what? Set us free. Okay, so we want to the next piece, the breastplate of righteousness. So in armor, the breastplate was obviously important because it protected like all of the vital organs, right? So why righteousness?
I think maybe this is also kind of relating directly to Christ, because the Bible says that we have the righteousness of Christ. It's almost like Christ's righteousness, boom, is put on us.
Yeah.
He is actually the one that protects us then.
Yeah, that was good. I even like the little sound effect, the little, you know, Christ's righteousness, boom. That was good. Right? That idea, like you can almost see the idea of the breastplate of being righteousness, protecting our heart, protecting who we are. Yeah, good. Anyone else have that issue where it feels like Satan's attacking you in your righteousness? That idea of you being not good enough? Not being able to measure up? That's righteousness, right? I mean, righteousness literally means, so it literally deals with the covenant and the covenant relationship we have with God. And righteousness is acting in a right way according to a covenant. And we all know that we don't, right? That we're not perfect. That we don't really measure up in our actual self. And so that Satan uses that to get at us and to point things out and go, look at that, you're not so perfect, right? Good.
That's definitely completely one side of it. There's also another side of it, right? It's the truth thing is that if we're doing something wrong, lying to ourselves, and that's why we need to have the truth.
Sure.
And if we're not right with God, then that can be an open door for the enemy.
Yeah, so the alternative, the other side of that is we could be ignoring the whole work of the Holy Spirit when he's trying to lead us back into righteousness because we have not been. Yeah, good. Yeah, to some extent, you could look at this like, okay, so just putting on righteousness mean me being more righteous. I think maybe there's a part of that, right? Like maybe living in righteousness, living in a right way with God. But I also think it's important to recognize that our righteousness is not based upon our obedience, like how good we do at living out, like being in right standing in the covenant. Our righteousness is based upon Christ and being clothed in his righteousness, right? As Christians, when we accept Christ as our Savior, we're declared righteous. We're clothed in Christ's righteousness. So when God looks at us, that's how he sees us. He sees us as righteous based upon Christ and his word. So I think to some extent, the breastplate of righteousness is about recognizing that, like remembering the fact that we have been clothed in Christ's righteousness. So, in other words, in those times when we don't feel like we're measuring up, and Satan, as the accuser, is trying to say, look at you, you're doing wrong, you're messing up, it is our solution to that is not to try better, try harder to measure up more. It is by maybe wrapping ourselves a little tighter in the Christ's righteousness. Does that make sense? Like reminding ourselves all the more of the fact that our righteousness is not based on how good we do, But I recognize by recognizing that our righteousness is based upon Christ and what he has done. Now that does not keep us doing the wrong things, like what Joe was saying. It means we have to then, we are supposed to live that out. But battling against the accuser's lies against us means recognizing where our righteousness really comes from. Okay, so next comes the combat boots. So here specifically, our feet are to be shod with the readiness of the gospel of peace. This is a little bit more difficult because it's like not as straightforward as righteousness and truth. So is this about the gospel or about our readiness or about peace? It's kind of a tough question, right? Let me just say that as I study this, I think what it's saying is that that our feet being shod with the readiness of gospel peace, the feet being shod is the readiness piece, and what they are shod with is the gospel of peace. So what do we mean by the gospel of peace?
The gospel, isn't that word
mean
good news?
Good news of peace. Yes. Yeah, so it's the good news of the peace that we have with God through Christ. Yeah.
Well, this section was about the battle we're in.
Yeah.
And so then the gospel of peace is kind of that the fact that we have the righteousness of God and the fact that we have the victory, like those are the things that are the gospel of peace.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're currently in this battle, and recognizing that peace is sure. It's like it's complete. It's already done. It's like it's something that we can have confidence in. Okay. Anyone else?
So in the style of combat that the Romans were used to. Roman wrestling. So your feet provide your base. If you lose your footing, you will lose the fight. So your feet are your foundation, and so much so that they would actually take your sandals and stick nails to the bottom of them and crush these.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So the when he's saying having these shoes for your feet, it's not about this is our foundation. Like this is the essential thing that we need to continue to hold on to and remember as well.
Yeah.
Because this provides the strength for us to actually enter into battle.
Yeah. That's good. I like that. I did not know that about the nails and the shoes. That's really cool. So this is talking about our foundation. Let me talk about it this way. So in the spiritual battle, Satan wants us afraid. He wants us immobilized. He wants us disrupted. And if he can't defeat us, he wants us ineffective. He wants us cowering in fear, discouraged. And I like the fact that Paul specifically points to the gospel of peace, because when we kind of think of the gospel, we many times think of other words, like the gospel of grace, the gospel of forgiveness, the gospel of salvation, right? More those words. But the gospel of peace means peace with God, and that peace that we have with God is based upon Christ and what he did, not based upon any of our own doing. You see, Christ became the propitiation for our sins. You know what the word propitiation means? What?
Payment.
Yeah, it talks about payment. It talks about, like, literally this idea of a price that has been paid by someone in order to bring two parties back together. This idea of, like, atonement, like an atonement sacrifice that has been made in order to make things right between two parties. It carries with it the idea of appeasement. Maybe you're familiar with the idea of appeasement, like something being appeased or like, satisfying wrath. And specifically, this is dealing with Christ, through Christ's sacrifice, the wrath of God towards sin has been satisfied because of Christ's sacrifice, so that we can then be reconciled or brought back to a right relationship with God and have peace with him, be at peace with him, no longer have that any wrath directed toward us because of sin. No matter what we face in this world, that peace with God has been accomplished. Jesus said, my peace I give you, not as the world gives. Let not your heart be troubled, and do not be afraid. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, you have overcome the world. In the midst of the battle that we face, the gospel of peace reminds us that we have overcome. The next is the shield. A shield would obviously be very important to deflect the blows of the enemy. And here, in the spiritual battle, our shield is faith. So, what's faith?
Being sure of what you hope for and certain of what you do not see.
Yeah, that's the Hebrews answer. Being sure of what we hope for, certain of what we do not see. Faith carries with it the idea of belief. But also belief in action, so trusting Christ, right? Like us having faith, even though we can't see it, being able to have confidence in Christ. Okay, so specifically the shield of faith is to extinguish the flaming darts of the evil one. How does faith do that? So not relying upon what we can and can't prove, but having faith that he can.
Undoing Satan's attacks.
Good. And it ties directly in with the truth we've already talked about. Good. Anyone else? Yeah.
C.S. Lewis talks about how faith is remembering what we know in the time before it's inconvenient to know it.
Yeah.
Right? So if, say, I'm tempted to cheat on my taxes or what have you, right?
Oh.
I know that that God wants to trust me and God tells me to pay my taxes. But in the moment when I look at my money, go, man, it should be nice to have that money, right? I need faith in order to defeat that temptation that to take from that. You can insert whatever example.
Yeah,
you like that.
That's good. So remembering what we know, even when it's inconvenient to know it, or when it's maybe difficult to know it, right? Like when everything else stands in the way of us feeling that or believing or acting upon that, having faith is what helps us to do that. Good. I think the devil's schemes, you know, includes lies and trickery and anything that can cause us to doubt God and question his will. And sometimes in the midst of those circumstances, we wonder, does God really love us? Does he really have my best interest in mind? Does he really understand what I'm going through? Does he really see me right now? Why is he not working in the way I think he should? Maybe I know better than he does about what should happen in my life or what I need to do. All these kind of questions come up. And in the midst of those times, what we need is faith. Faith helps us to look past our circumstances and to see God and to see the kingdom of heaven and to act accordingly, like Paul did when he's sitting in prison after having been beaten, chained to a guard, in danger of losing his life, and he's sitting there singing hymns, telling us to rejoice always, and writing these letters of encouragement like we're reading right now. Like, Paul had this ability to, it's like almost like he didn't see the bars of the prison, and that's faith. It's like looking past our circumstances and past the things that might get in the way, and still believing, still trusting. Next comes the helmet. So the helmet's important because it guards the head of the soldier. And specifically, the helmet is salvation. So why salvation? Is this different? Is this like an extra piece? I mean, like, why salvation? He's already mentioned some of the things he's mentioned. Let me ask it this way. Is salvation something that is not complete yet? Is your salvation accomplished already?
Yes.
Yes. Let me ask you this. If somebody who is needing to be rescued, say they're drowning in the water and they can't swim, When the boat comes, like the boat is there, but they're still drowning. Are they already saved? Are they already rescued? No. They don't think of themselves as being rescued until they get in the boat. And I think the same thing is true with us, is that our salvation, I think somebody was saying this earlier. Maybe Sierra. Our salvation has already been accomplished. It's a done deal. Even though we are still faced, we're still in the midst of the drowning or the struggles that we're faced with. The scripture constantly speaks of this fact that our salvation is a done deal. It's already been accomplished. However, we're still in this spiritual battle. God's already won the war, but Satan is still fighting right now. So maybe putting on salvation like a helmet is us growing in our understanding of our salvation, realizing what it means that this work has been done. I know when I was growing up that I knew I was saved, but I didn't really know what that meant. Scripture is full of details about our salvation and about what that means for us and about how God has dealt with sin and purchased our freedom and rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of light. Learning more about salvation can help us stand firm even when Satan tries to make us feel unworthy or hopeless. Then the last piece of armor Paul mentions is the sword of the Spirit, the word of God. Why does Paul equate the Bible with the sword? Yes, in Hebrews, it speaks of the Bible being living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. Yeah. So the sword seems to suggest an offensive weapon, some way of fighting back. It's living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It's also God-breathed. It's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. I'm currently discipling my oldest daughter, Ansley, and just this past week we were talking about the Bible, and one of the things that we looked at was that when Jesus was tempted by Satan, you remember that story? What does Jesus fight back with? The Word, right? Every single time he's tempted by Satan, what he does is he quotes Scripture each and every time until Satan leaves. I think that's what it looks like to use the Word to stand against the devil's schemes. Fight back with the Word. Goes back to what Rachel was saying, knowing the Word. We have to be able to know what God has already said so that we can be able to use it in the time of our trouble. Okay, so that's the end of the armor. Paul isn't quite finished yet. He wraps things up with this. He says, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication, to that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. So Paul ends by calling us to pray. Why do you think prayer? Why is prayer part of this passage on the armor? Even though he doesn't ascribe a piece of armor to this, it's part of this sentence, this run-on sentence that Paul is used for. Why pray? Recognizing the fact that this is a spiritual battle, and so we can't be fighting this spiritual battle with our own tools, with our own resources. Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians 10. He says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds." I think sometimes prayer is our last option. It's like the last thing we do. It's like after we've exhausted everything else, we finally get around to prayer. And in this passage, we're reminded that it should be the first thing we do, that it's part of our natural defenses against the schemes of the evil one. Okay, so that's the passage. anything that you want, that you're going to take, like, what are you going to take from this? I know we're a little bit late, so you may be going, okay, when is this going to end? Before I give you my closing thought, what are you going to take from this passage? What is it that strikes you from this armor of God idea? Yeah.
I've recently been just sort of questioning how we come to the ideas that we live with, or like what the Christian life should look like. There's a lot of things that we kind of like often answer with what a Christian should do, pray, read their Bible, give their anxiety to the Lord, various things like that. So I was recently questioning, how do we come to those things? Why do we believe that? Why do we think we should live differently than others and stuff? And looking at this passage, it sort of lays out a lot of the answers to what I've been wrestling with. Prayer being tied with knowing the truth, which comes through reading the Bible, things like that. So for me, I feel like it's just like a summary to an answer to what I've been wrestling with.
Good. That's good. Yeah. So like you've been wrestling with this already, and yeah, it just kind of brings that on. Good. I like that. Thanks. Anyone else? So I want to close with this. I want to close with the idea that Paul he's not saying these things like he's trying to pump up a group of soldiers who are going to go into battle. He's not calling us to win a battle. He's not calling us to go on the offensive and to take the battle to Satan. This is about us and what we need. The armor is all about our protection. I think he's opening our eyes to see the reality of the battle that is waging against us and challenging us to stand our ground in the face of that battle. Like he's saying, you need this. This is for you. And he's reminding us to not rely upon our own strength, to not rely upon earthly ways of fighting this battle, but to rely upon the strength of our Lord who's already won the war. So one day we're going to enjoy the fruits of victory. We're going to be with him in heaven. But here on earth, the battle is still fierce. Even though the battle is won, it still wages. And I know that's a weird concept, but Satan does not go down easily. And he is waging this battle against us. And standing our ground means relying not on ourselves, not on our physical resources, but to rely upon God. And to recognize that he has given us what we need to be able to stand firm. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for your love and grace. I thank you for the fact that you have given us all we need. But Lord, it is easy for us sometimes to get caught up in the midst of the battle and to forget. Lord, I pray that you would be with each one of us. Lord, I don't know what this battle looks like in our lives. I don't know. People are struggling with all different kinds of things. There may be some people here today who are really struggling in the midst of this battle. And so I pray for our protection. I pray for your work, that you would strengthen maybe the pieces of armor that are a little bit weak right now in our lives. You remind us of your presence. You remind us of your power. And that you would give us the strength to stand. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Well, stand up, we'll sing our closing song together. Amen.